أهلا بكم مشاهدينا إلى هذا اللقاء الخاص الذي أجريه اليوم مع المبعوث الخاص الأمريكي لشؤون المناخ جون كيري. سيد كيري، أهلا بك معنا في سكاي نيوز عربية اليوم وفي هذا اللقاء الخاص. نحن نقترب من كوب 28، أنت في بري كوب الآن، هناك ترقب كبير، توقعات كبيرة تحيط بهذا المؤتمر، ما هي أمالكم؟
My hopes for COP 28 are that it will meet the historic moment that this is. We have a huge challenge, existential. Everybody in the world is feeling the impact of the climate crisis. It comes from one thing. It's coming from burning fossil fuel where we don't capture the emissions, unabated fossil fuel burning. So those emissions are creating this problem. It's not rocket science. So what do we have to do? We have to reduce those emissions, and that requires us and transform our economy to a clean energy economy. We can do that, and it won't, you know, we can create jobs, we create new opportunity, new technologies. It's sort of the continual evolution of economies from all of time. We had the Industrial Revolution. This will be bigger than the Industrial Revolution. My hopes are that this meeting of the parties in Dubai shortly is going to put money on the table with respect to the finance. It will build trust with the global south, and it will reach out with real compromise to come together, all of us, in a clear pathway to keep 1.5 degrees as the limit.
لكن يبقى التساؤل، كيف تختلف هذه القمة؟ كيف تختلف كوب 28 عن قمم المناخ السابقة؟ ما هي العناصر أو ما هو النهج الجديد اللي يمكننا توقعه هذا العام؟
Well, it differs in that we now have Mother Nature screaming at us in ways we've never heard before. I mean, we have, you know, glaciers melting, we have fires all around the planet, we have record heat, every day there's a new record, water scarcity everywhere. So I think people are all over the planet learning and feeling the crisis of this particular challenge. So that's a little bit different. The second thing that is different is we have more an awareness of how we respond, what do we have to do? And there's a clarity to the laying out of the game plan going forward. The third thing that is different is this is in a region that produces oil and gas, that is a fossil fuel dependent set of economies, but they're changing. The UAE has been a leader in that change, and they've been ahead of the curve in investing in alternative renewable energy. They wanted to take on this task, and I believe they have an opportunity to stand up and lead in a very effective way. All of us have to come to the table to compromise, to work together in the interest of stopping the emissions that are creating this problem.
بحديثكم عن هذه الدول المنتجة للنفط، ما مدى أهمية إشراك هذه الدول في المحادثات البيئية؟
Very important. I believe it's critical to our ability to solve the problem. We have to have everybody at the table. I mean, every country has to come to the table. And there are different levels of responsibility, in a sense. There's different levels of challenge for these countries. 48 sub-Saharan African countries equal 0.55% of all the emissions. 20 countries, which are big economies, developing some of them too, but big still, are responsible for almost 80% of all the emissions. So we have to approach this with a sense of equity and fairness. We don't want people left behind in the transition. That's possible. But we also need to speed up the transition. Mm-hmm. Or we don't do what's necessary to avoid the worst consequences of the crisis.
طيب سيد كيري، إذا ما نظرنا إلى القمم السابقة، قمم المناخ السابقة، ما هي التقدمات الملموسة التي تم تحقيقها، وكيف تشكل هذه الإنجازات لربما أهداف للقمة الجديدة COP 28؟
When I took this job, when President Biden asked me to take this on, that was in January of 2021, when he was sworn in, the same day I was sworn in. And we started this work. Then we were heading on this planet to almost 4 degrees centigrade of warming, 3.7 to 4 degrees. Now we're heading towards 2.5, but if we did, all the things that were promised in Glasgow and all the things that were promised in Sharm el-Sheikh. We did them, and we're not doing them all. But if we did, we would be at 1.8 or 1.7 degrees by 2050. That simply shows that if countries will step up, if we will do what we promised to do, rebuild trust with our citizens all around the world, we can actually win this fight. That's on the table. And this COP is the place where we have to close the gap. We have to come together and really start to do what we promised we would do.
وهنا أريد أن أسأل كيف تصف مستوى التعاون الدولي في التصدي لتغير المناخ؟
Well, in terms of the talk, this was another opportunity for people to come together and lay out the game plan. But what we really have to do is follow through on the promises that are made. We have to speed up the pace at which we are transitioning to a clean energy economy. For instance, in the United States last year, over 90% of the new energy that we created in America came from renewable energy. This is happening around the world. We now have Germany that's at 50% of all its energy base is now renewable. We have other countries that are moving very rapidly. Some countries are exclusively on renewables and have proven that you can still have an energy confidence, you can have energy security in doing that. Now, some countries have a different economic challenge because they have larger industry. They have steel and concrete and very heat-intensive manufacturing processes. So that's harder. But there are still new technologies coming online and coming soon. So, the small modular reactors, nuclear power will be part of this transition. So hopefully will new battery storage and hydrogen and possibly fusion, who knows. So this is a very exciting moment. And I think that people need to look at it, not as a, to be avoided in the sense of, we have to deal with the crisis. The crisis represents opportunity. And what we need to do is build on that opportunity to reconnect ourselves to our fellow citizens and to people all around the world who are getting angrier and angrier at the lack of action and the lack of focus.
إلى أي مدى نحن نحتاج اليوم إلى هذا النهج المتوازن للانتقال العادل للطاقة وتحديدا لتحقيق أمن الطاقة العالمي في هذه المرحلة؟
Well, the ingredients are several fold. There's not just one thing. For instance, governments have to create the structure in their country for things to be able to happen. And they need to begin to deal with the demand of citizens for the energy. That demand can change. When you start to make electric vehicles available at an affordable rate, then the faster people get into those electric vehicles, the quicker you turn down the demand for gasoline. Already the International Energy Agency has said they can determine from the things that are happening now in terms of the transition that by 2030, there will be a terminal downturn in the demand for fossil fuels. Why? Because more and more people will have access to renewables, more and more people will be, their countries will be transitioning to them. Governments can help make that happen. Governments can also help to deal with subsidies. That's another form of demand impact. Okay. If you reduce the subsidies, you begin to equalize the choices people have in the marketplace. So there are lots of different ingredients here. The companies themselves that produce the energy, they have to clean up. And many of the oil and gas companies are now making certain that they do their early directly responsible emissions called Scope 1 and Scope 2. They have to reduce those emissions for which they are directly responsible. And then the final grouping are the ones you're not directly responsible for. It's harder to do. But governments and cities and states can make the rules and put them in place that have an impact. The example of that is California, where the governor is putting in place very strict standards, which because that state is about the fourth largest economy in the world, that will have a profound impact on every other state in the United States. And indeed, on what kind of cars are manufactured and what kind of energy is provided all through our country.
هنا تحدثنا عن الولايات المتحدة. ماذا عن الدول النامية الأخرى؟ ما هي الإجراءات المتخذة لدعم هذه الدول في جهودها للتكيف وللتخفيف من تأثيرات التغيرات المناخية وهي من أكثر الدول المتضررة؟
The developing nations have every reason in the world to be somewhat upset because they are not responsible for this crisis, but they also wind up paying more for the lending that they want to use for the money they need to be able to make the transition. So we've been working with the World Bank. The World Bank is now in a position to be able to make much more money available for lending. We're working with philanthropies to be able to help reduce the cost of money, of capital. And we're also working with the international community to try to have a common approach to some of this so that from one market to another, you can't escape responsibility for these transitions.
هل تتوقعون أن يصل مؤتمر الأطراف COP28 إلى تفعيل صندوق الخسائر والأضرار؟ هذا موضوع مهم جدا بالنسبة للجميع اليوم، خاصة بعد الكثير من العرقلة في المحادثات كما تبعنا مؤخرا.
We have to reach an agreement on the loss and damage. That is the obligation we set for ourselves in Sharm el-Sheikh when we created this new fund, and we accelerated the pace at which we have to do this from 2 years to 1 year. So we're trying to show good faith in that process. But everybody needs to step up and be part of the solution. Mm-hmm. You can't run away and hide and say, well, they have to be responsible to put the money in, but we're not responsible. You know, where you have people who can afford it. I'm not talking about smaller economies. I'm talking among the larger economies where people can afford and do it. But there are lots of folks who can step up and be part of that transitional process. We need to help those less developed countries to be able to develop their own economies and to have their own power sources, which are clean, hopefully, but that's more expensive. So we have to step up to provide the financing that allows them to be able to make that transition. We've been working on this very hard. We have new vehicles, financial vehicles that have been created. The World Bank now has more money to be able to lend. We have blended finance mechanisms. We've done an agreement with Indonesia where we've shown how we can bring private capital and public money and philanthropy money to the table to lower the risk of a particular agreement and then to be able to marry the deal with the country. And the example of that is Just Energy Transition Partnership in Indonesia. We have worked one in Vietnam. We hope at the COP we'll be in a position to announce a new effort with Vietnam, which will begin to transition away from coal and begin to deploy more renewables and build more transmission, which will excite their market so that new clean energy will come to the table. It's really an exciting time. There's not enough time in the day or the week or the month or year to pull all of these deals together, but we hope the marketplace will begin to just take off and companies will come and say, hey, we're ready to help you. And you work out a fair arrangement and affordable energy. And as you do that, the price of energy will go down and the availability of these technologies will go up.
سيد كاري، نحن نعيش الكثير من التغيرات. كيف يمكن لكل هذه العوامل السياسية التي تحيط بنا أن تؤثر على تقدم حلول التغير المناخي، خاصة ونحن نقترب من هذه القمة؟
My focus is, I mean, there are plenty of focus of the United States government. President Biden and Secretary Blinken are totally focused on the crisis of Gaza and challenge of the war. Our focus here is on a different crisis, but it's a crisis. And our focus is on a crisis which is also taking lives. 7 million people a year die from the lack of quality air. And that comes from greenhouse gas pollution. So we're focused on, you know, it's a different kind of challenge. You don't have bombs going off every day. You don't have people being killed on a daily basis in terms of the violence, but you do have people who are dying every day because of this crisis. So we feel that responsibility, and I think we're going to do everything in our power to change that dynamic and be able to provide safety and security to our citizens in a different way.
وهنا أمامنا فرصة ذهبية COP28. ألا تجدون أنه بإمكانه أن يوحد كل هذه الجهود؟
COP28 is an incredible opportunity for people to come together. I mean, there'll be tens of thousands of people visiting the Arab Emirates. There will be enormous focus on this. We need to meet the challenge. We need to meet the moment. And I think people are going to work very hard to do that. You know, there's so much crisis around the world. There's so much misery that people are feeling and seeing and living with, that the world needs some good news. We need to make sure that we're doing everything in our power to use this opportunity to the advantage of everybody else in the world. And it's rare, you know, it's a wonderful thing in public life to you know, have a moment where coming together with your friends and colleagues, and I know so many of these people over the years, they're good people, they want to make a difference. And I hope we can come together and do something which not only saves a local community or saves a country or a region, but this is a planet we're talking about that is in distress. And I don't think it gets bigger than that.
ونحن حقيقة نتطلع إلى كل هذه الإيجابية في القمة المرتقبة التي نلقاكم فيها مرة جديدة. شكرا للمبعوث الخاص للرئيس الأمريكي لشؤون المناخ جون كيري على قبولك دعوة سكاي نيوز عربية. مشاهدينا شكرا لكم لمتابعة هذا اللقاء. نلقاكم بخير.